So we will continue our discussion with the basics of rotating machines. And as you know, I started with a somewhat, not a rotating machine, but a sort of linear machine. Just quickly I will review what I did last time. Suppose you have got a north pole along a track and below there is a south pole. Suppose it continues indefinitely. And if you have a conductor which is perpendicular to the plane of the paper, and if it moves with a constant velocity v, say v naught, then there will be induced voltage across the two ends of the conductor. And if you have a view from the top, then the conductor will look like this one. And if it moves like this, then this becomes a seat of EMF that we have seen. And the nature of the voltage that you will be getting here will be BLV, V naught, and it will be DC in nature, direct. So it will have a positive, negative like that. So which one? This one will be positive. This one will be negative. That is correct. B is in this direction, in this diagram. So B, V like this. Now, another important thing I would like to tell with regard to this. Suppose this is a simple generator having a single conductor, two ends you can supply load. Now suppose this distribution of the field I can manipulate. Let us assume theoretically that I have done like this. Suppose some portion of the track is under say north pole, then there will be say south pole, and it continues like this, once again north here. Are you getting the field pattern? On the stator portion of this simple machine, I can change it like this, so that this becomes south here, this becomes north, and this becomes south. And suppose this conductor travels from left to right, once again with the same velocity V naught. Then the once again the induced voltage will be BL V naught. But as you can see, when it is under this pair of poles in this zone, the polarity of the induced voltage here will be plus minus. And when it enters this zone and it becomes somewhere here, it will become zero because there will be no field. But when it enters in this zone, the polarity will get reversed. And you can manipulate this field pattern. Suppose somehow, I mean, how you will do, I will tell you later. Suppose the field pattern produced by the stator, I will manipulate like this. That is, this is suppose the strength of B along the space length, along the length here. And this whole complicated diagram I can now represent by a field pattern like this, not. And a conductor is moving like this with a velocity v. So in this case, strictly speaking, this field pattern should be like this, a rectangular one. Not, then there is no field like this. But let us assume by some means I have been able to make this field pattern to be sinusoidal in nature. And suppose this conductor moves. Then if you look from the top here, then this conductor will at this position here, suppose this is the length of the conductor. And let us mark the terminals as say A, this terminal B. Therefore, so long the conductor will be between this zone, the induced voltage polarity here will be plus, here will be minus. And when it comes under the south pole, the polarity will reverse. That, of course, I can represent it in this form. Suppose B is equal to some B max sine of that pi by, say, whatever is the period. That way I can write as a sine function. Is not? I can convert it to theta. Suppose this is space angle theta. Also space angle theta. So in this fashion, if you represent it, the induced voltage, BAB, will be just proportional to BLV, V naught. Suppose V naught is the speed, and it can be written as some V max L V naught sin theta. Therefore, induced voltage across AB will also become sinusoidal in nature. Therefore, remember that in a conductor, induced voltage will follow the same pattern as that of the B distribution, flux density distribution. That is, you should note. Now, you can further, suppose this in terms of angle, if I want to represent this, I will write 0, pi, 2 pi, like this. And this height is, suppose, some B max. Now, what I am trying to tell, and this is pi by 2, that suppose instead of this point, you listen carefully. Suppose instead of a single coil, single conductor, I will now place two conductors separated by pi, such that, that is, there will be a conductor here, if it is say theta at any arbitrary position from the origin, this is suppose theta. The other conductor you place at pi plus theta. This point is pi plus theta, such that this separation is also pi. See another conductor. Now, you also draw the top view, looking from top, if you draw this second conductor, it will be like this. Okay, and both of them are moving with same velocity V naught, such that the angle of separation remains pi all the time. Suppose this terminal is C, this terminal is T. So, across this, the ends of the conductor CD, there will be also induced voltage. What will be the polarity of this voltage? Opposite to this one. This will become plus at that point of time, and this will become minus. Okay. And these two conductors, therefore, if I join at the back by a piece of wire, this becomes a coil. And what will be the induced voltage across it? It will be twice the induced voltage in each of the conductors. They are additively connected in series. So this will be twice B L V. So what I want to tell, this B, variation of B, B max sin theta, will take care of this polarity. You only specify that this is D terminal, this is B terminal, and this is your VDB, like this. Potential of D with respect to B will be twice BLV, and the way B varies, induced voltage across the coil will vary. So remember, in a coil, so a coil will have two coil sides. These are called coil sides. And at the back, they are joined. And you can have induced voltage like this, if it moves. Okay. The same thing, as you can easily understand, to have a field distribution all along your track, and to want to induce AC voltage, B pattern must be of this form. And the coil should be like this. So you require an infinite length sort of B distribution. Now, from this, you can easily get this same thing, same effect, by doing this particular thing, going to a rotating machine. What I will do is this. That is, suppose you have got on the stator a structure like this. This is the stator structure I am drawing. with two projected poles. This is stator. And it has got a length perpendicular to the plane of the paper as usual. And you have on the rotor, a pair of slots only, which are diametrically opposite. So your rotor looks like this one. Now, if you place two conductors in these two slots, and at the back they are joined, that is, if you look from the top, the coil will look like this way. They are joined at the back electrically, and you will have two free terminals available to you coming out from the slots. If you look from the top, it will look like this. Now, the stator structure can have a winding, or they may be permanent magnet. Just for understanding's sake, I will not put any winding there right now. Let us see that there are two poles, permanent magnets, or it can be produced by coils wound on it and passing some current like that. Now, if this machine is rotated by a prime mover, at a, say, constant RPM, then let us see what will happen. This conductor, this one, suppose this is AB, and this is CD, like this side of CD. So as it rotates, and suppose let us consider the position of the rotor at this instant when the plane of the coil is parallel to the flux lines here. Then at this point, this conductor coil side, this is the coil side, these are called coil side. And this is another coil side. Now, coil side AB is like this at this point. Now, when AB side will be under the center of the North Pole, automatically CD side will be under the center of the South Pole. And for that matter, when coil 1 is any position here, whatever is the strength of the flux at this point, coil, other coil side will be also positioned in that fashion. Strength of the field is same, but only thing, the polarity has reversed. Are you getting? This will be maintained all along as it rotates. So, in this case also, at this point, I can find out what will be the polarity of the induced voltage by applying this right-hand rule. This is BLV. It will be like this. So, this side will be plus, minus, like this. And this will be opposite. So, the induced voltage will be like this. And when, after 90-degree rotation, coil will come here, there will be no induced voltage. And when this coil comes there and it comes here, there will be reversal of the voltage. So you find that this situation has been nicely, now they are in a compact form. You can have two poles and this will be repeated indefinitely, so in a rotating machine. So it is like this. Another important thing I would like to tell, of course these are very small tidbits things, but you should know, because these terms I will often refer. For example, so this becomes a simple generator now. What you would like to do? Across BD, you would like to connect a load such that this generator can deliver power. Now the question is, how will you access these two terminals? See, these two terminals will be rotating, these two coil sides along with it. And you want to connect a stationary load, say a resistance or a bulb like that. So, how to access those two terminals for external use? So, not only brasses, slip ring and brass arrangement will be made. Slip ring and brass arrangement. For accessing rotor terminals. rotor terminals. So slip ring and brass arrangements can be made like this. Suppose these two ends of the coil, they will be rotating, and what you do on the shaft of the machine, suppose this is the shaft of the machine. This is the shaft of the machine. What you do, shaft will also rotate. So these two terminals, you bring it along the shaft. Say this is from B. And another is from D. And then in this shaft you insert two copper rings. Copper rings. So one copper rings is like this. It is inserted. But it is inserted in such a way that it remains insulated from the shaft. That is, if you look from this end in the shaft, it will look shaft, then some insulating material, then your ring. If you look from one end of the shaft. Now, the one end of this coil is terminated here, is joined, either with a screw or things like that, firmly joined together. Similarly, you put another copper ring into the shaft. Another copper ring in the shaft. Once again insulated from the shaft. And you take the other free end of the wire and firmly fix it. That is from D. Firmly fix it. Therefore, as your shaft rotates, your copper ring, this copper ring will always represent terminal B, and this copper ring, any part of it, will always represent the terminal D. Now, what you do to make these two terminals appear stationary, you connect two brasses, carbon brasses, which are fixed. Stationary brass. So these stationary brasses are placed with the help of spring tension in such a way that it will touch the copper rings all the time at a fixed point, and the ring will go on rotating with the shaft, but these brasses will always make contact with this. Okay. So that is, if this is the ring, if this is the brass, it is like this, stationary brass, and this continues to rotate. Therefore, this brass will always make contact with B, means it will make contact with this B, and this one this. So slip ring brass arrangements are very much used whenever you want to access any rotor terminals for external connection. Say you want to connect a meter or a resistance like that. Of course, in DC machine, we will find automatically the rotor terminals can be accessed by another different way, by using commutator segment and brass. That I will discuss at that time. But in general, for induction machines and for synchronous machine, rotor terminals are accessed by slip ring and brass arrangement. So, this is there. So, I can access this one, these two terminals, appropriately, and then supply it to the load. So this is a simple generator. Now, I will tell you, a machine may have, apart from two poles that I have shown, it might have a large number of poles. That is, it could have four poles, six poles, like that. Of course, it cannot have odd number of poles, because the flux with whatever is produced must complete its path. So north south like that, in that pair it will come. So for that matter, you consider this generator, say four polar construction, let us say. A four pole machine, how it will look like. So this is, suppose on the stator you have got, this is north pole, another south pole is here, another north pole is there, and another south pole is there, and you have a rotor like this, and this is the air gap of the machine. Now suppose you consider a single conductor or a coil, whatever way you think. Now concentrate on the single conductor and the voltage induced across its free end. In this case, as the conductor moves from this point and makes a complete revolution, you can easily show that the voltage induced will make two cycles. Okay, suppose the initial position of the slot was here, say in the magnetic neutral position. Initially, suppose I am starting my time counting from this instant. This is the single conductor. What I want to tell, suppose this is omega t equal to 0. And suppose I want to sketch the induced voltage against time or omega t. Suppose omega t equal to 0, induced voltage will be 0. There is no field. Then when it comes under the center of the north pole, maximum induced voltage will be there. Say, okay, when it comes under the center of the north pole. And when it once again comes here, induced voltage will be once again 0. When it comes under the center of the south pole, induced voltage will be once again maximum but negative, because V direction is same, only B direction has reversed. VLV is the induced voltage. So what I want to tell, so it will be like this. I mean somewhat. So one cycle will be complete when it comes here. Zero, positive maximum, zero, negative maximum, and once again zero. Then what will happen? You will get another cycle. So two cycles of EMF you will be getting for one complete rotation for this particular set. That is, if you have increased the number of poles, you will get more number of cycles of EMF, which is not the case in case of a two-polar machine. In case of two-polar machine, when it completes one cycle, your EMF cycle will be also one. Therefore, in a multipolar machine, number of cycles of EMF generated is different from the mechanical rotation of this one. In fact, we have to then distinguish between electrical angle and mechanical angle. That is what I want to tell now. The idea of electrical and mechanical angle. This is very important concept, electrical and mechanical angle. What are they? Suppose I will denote electrical angle by theta E and denote mechanical angle by theta M. Suppose the machine is P polar machine, total number of poles are P. Tell me how they are related. How they are related. Mechanical angle means the angle I will measure by a protector, suppose. What is the position of the coil? Theta E should be equal to P by 2 into theta m. If it is a two-polar machine, electrical angle and mechanical angle will be same. However, if it is a multipolar machine, then they will be different. So this is one very useful relationship which will be often given to you. I mean, the application of this one, at this stage you can do several things. For example, see, in our country, power is mostly generated by thermal sources, is not? Turbo alternators are used to generate power. Suppose number of poles of that turbo alternator is 2 and you want to generate 50 hertz power. At what RPM you should run that generator? 3000 RPM. If your machine happens to have 4 poles generator, then at what RPM you should run the machine? 1500 RPM. So it is not a unique speed. It depends upon the number of poles of your generator. In order to generate, at what RPM you should run should be fixed by the frequency you want to generate. Of course, frequency is 50 hertz fixed, so you can find out. Therefore, you can also, from this one, the speed relationship you can also find out. Taking the derivative with respect to time, both the sides, electrical speed will be equal to also, this way it will be related, mechanical speed. That is also true. Correct. Okay. Now I will tell you, so this is the simplest machine which one can think of, a particularly synchronous generator. Of course, analysis you forget about at this stage, but one of the simplest machines. Now I want to tell you some basic facts in a rotating machine without doing any mathematics like that, which we can understand. Basically, the electromagnetic torque will be developed by the machine whenever, whether it is motor or generator, we have seen, is not? Either it is a generator or motor, electromagnetic torque will be developed. In case of generator, what are the other torques which will be present? In case of generator, that is the prime mover torque, the driving torque, your turbine, whatever drives. So in case of generator, T prime mover will be there. T prime mover will be there. And T electromagnetic torque will be there. And if your generator runs at constant speed, I told you these two must be equal. Then only it can run at constant speed. In case of motor, what are the two torques which will be acting? Electromagnetic torque will be acting and the load torque. And your motor will run at constant speed when these two are equal, motor. This is generator. In case of a generator, if at any time T prime mover is greater than TE, what that will indicate? Machine will accelerate that generator. In case of a motor, if load torque becomes greater than electromagnetic torque, it will decelerate. And electromagnetic torque, if it exceeds, machine will accelerate. These two you remember. Now, I will tell you under what condition any machine, whether AC, DC, whatever its kind may be, the fundamental thing is this electromagnetic torque will be generated, can be seen from many angles. One of the angles is you calculate BIL, multiply with R diameter by 2 to get the expression for the torque like that. But essentially, if you look, I mean globally, as an external user of the machine, you can say the interaction of the two fields will be responsible for production of torque. What do I mean? In a machine, stator has a winding. Stator will carry some current and it will produce its field. Suppose a machine produces NSSS on the stator. Suppose this is the stator. This is the stator part of the winding. So it will ultimately produce some poles, magnetic poles it will produce when it carries current. So let us call NSSS, two polar machine, let us call. Rotor also houses, as I told you, some windings, and it will carry some current, And it will also produce magnetic poles. And that I will denote it by, say, NR, SR, on the face of the structure. So there is a magnet like this. We can visualize that these two magnets will interact and give you torque or force, whatever you call it. Okay. Now suppose it is a two-polar machine. Stator produces two poles. Rotor produces two poles. This is the rotor. And machine is supposed stationary. Nothing is there. Under this condition, what do you think the rotor will do? Rotor, these poles will experience a force like this. There will be a repelling force between NS and NR at this position. And there will be also a repelling force here, such that rotor will experience a torque and it will rotate. Okay. It will rotate in this direction. And suppose the inertia of the rotor, see, after 180 degree rotation, this is the stator, of course, is not free to rotate. It will not rotate. Stator 2 will experience a force in the opposite direction, stator poles. But stator is not allowed to rotate. So rotor will rotate. So rotor start rotating in this direction. Now, what I want to tell, this is suppose NSSS. Rotor rotates in this direction. And because of inertia or whatever it is, it comes like this. SR, NR. See, it has started rotating. It comes NS, SR, but it may overshoot here because of its inertia. Suppose it occupies this position. The moment it comes here, then in which direction rotor will experience torque? This SR will be attracted there, and this will be attracted here. So what I am trying to tell, that okay, two poles should be produced by stator and rotor. But additionally, some condition should be fulfilled in order that rotor produces unidirectional torque, steady value of unidirectional torque. Is not? Your machine should be capable of producing unidirectional constant magnitude torque at a particular steady operating point. Then tell me what condition you will attach. That is, stator should produce two poles, rotor should produce two poles in this case. What else you should tell about these two fields? Or in other words, I should tell it like this, I mean, perhaps you do not know, that, okay, let stator produce poles, rotor produce poles. Under this condition, we find direction of torque reverses, etc. Machine may fail. That is, the angle between these two, angle between these two fields should be constant or time invariant. So how that time invariant thing will come, that is, we'll see. But what I am trying to tell, mere presence of two fields in the stator and rotor may not produce steady electromagnetic torque continuously. If you want to produce steady torque, let rotor rotate. Rotor will rotate. Stator field will be produced. But suppose I, as an external observer, I can see the poles, I mean, physically suppose I can see. I should see rotor is rotating, stator is stationary, stator winding is carrying current, produced a field. Rotor has also produced a field. But externally, suppose I can see the fields, I must see them stationary with respect to me. The angle between these two is fixed. Then only all the time it will be producing torque. So you write down the angle between stator and rotor fields must be time invariant. Must be time invariant in order steady electromagnetic torque is produced by the machine. This is very important thing. It should be satisfied. How, that we'll see. Otherwise machine will fail to produce torque. Now, another important thing is that first I will tell you the result, then explain. That is, next point is that the number of poles produced by number of poles of stator and rotor must be same for steady production of torque. That is, you cannot have a machine which has produced two number of stator poles and four number of rotor poles. That will be useless. For this reason, because suppose at any point of time this is the position of the stator poles, NS, SS, two poles stator. And suppose rotor produces four poles, and I will call them as NR, SR, once again NR, SR, four poles it has produced. And suppose this is at a point of time, they are positioned like that. This rotor will experience forces. So NS and NR will give you force, repelling force to this fellow, NR. NS will attract SR, it will give you force like this. SR will be repelled by SS, it will give you force like this. And NR will be attracted. So, forces cancel out. Effective torque acting on the rotor will not be there. So, these two things are very important. One is, in any machine, DC machine, induction machine, synchronous machine, or single phase induction machine, whatever may be the case, if you find the machine is running steadily, it means it must have satisfied these two conditions. What are the conditions? The number of poles produced by stator and rotor must be same. That is one thing. And second thing is, the angle between these two fields must be time invariant. Otherwise, it will not be possible to produce steady electromagnetic torque. Now, with this one, we now go to this two, you should always remember. Now, I will once again tell you another basic thing. Suppose you want to make a generator. See, I am not doing any mathematics, just to give you some ideas, which are essential, I feel, one should know. This is, suppose you have got a four-pole stator. A simple generator I want to construct, AC generator. And these are, of course, joined here, stator. This is the stator part of the machine, iron. And here, of course, you can have windings to produce this north, south, etc., which I am not showing for clarity. Suppose the stator poles are, this is north, NS, SS, once again in SSS. And this is the rotor ion structure where I want to place a coil to have induced voltage and get power out of it. Okay. So what I will be doing? Suppose there are a pair of slots like this. So I have put one conductor here. And I have put another conductor here. If you look from the top, the coil will look like this way, joined at the back, top view if you take. Now you tell me how much will be the induced voltage at any point of time as the rotor is driven by the prime mover. I give you some time. At the two free ends, how much do you think the across the coil, how much voltage you will be getting? You will be getting zero voltage. Although across the individual conductors or coil sides, there will be induced voltage. BLV will be there. Why you will be getting zero voltage? Because this conductor, when it is under the north pole, and suppose it is rotating in this direction, so you can apply that right hand rule and find out this is plus, this is minus. What about the end of this conductor? It is also under the peak of the north pole and its direction of rotation is like this. Is it not? So it will also produce voltage like this, this polarity. So net voltage across this will be zero. Therefore, suppose I want to, however, a four-pole machine is possible, then what is wrong with my rotor coils? Rotor coils, then suppose this is the one side I have put, where should be the other coil side? It should be placed so that maximum voltage you get. It should be placed here. That is, this is not a correct choice. That is, you should not think that the span of the coil should be just, the coil side should be diametrically opposite. In fact, it should be positioned such that if at any time one coil side is under the center of north pole, the other coil side should be under the center of the south pole. So this is how it should be placed. Such that at any point of time, whatever flux it will see, this coil side, other coil side will see same amount of flux but of opposite polarity, and velocity direction being same, the voltages will be additive. Therefore, suppose we define a term called coil span. Coil span means the distance between the two coil sides. Angular displacement. Between the two coil sides. Coil sides I have already defined. Coil sides. That is this angle. How much they are separated. In a two polar machine, the coil span is how much? 180 degree. But since you are starting machine, you should be very careful about telling about the degrees. What 180 degree? What you will tell? Mechanical or electrical? In this case, both, because two polar machine, 180 degree, mechanical. In this case, mechanical angle, 90 degree. So mechanically 90 degree. 90 degree mechanical. But electrical degree? 180 degree. So it is always, we say that the for a single coil, the coil side should be placed 180 degree electrical apart. It should be, I mean, in general, right now, at this stage, 180 degree electrical apart. Always. In order to maximize the voltage, etc. Okay. So, the coil sides and how they are to be placed, I have told you. Now, I will come to the gradually, I will move to a machine. Suppose you consider a simple machine. It is not a machine. How to obtain the B distribution? Now, in a machine, we'll do a very little mathematics here. Suppose you have got a stator iron, stator structure. And let us assume it has got no slots. No slots. On the rotor, we have only a pair of slots. Rotor. And you have got a coil. It goes like this at the back joint. It comes out from the top. And this coil I will energize by a DC supply. The coils are brought out with slip ring brass arrangement for standard. So what I will do, I can represent it as a coil, rotor coil, and this I will connect perhaps to a DC supply to pass some current. So suppose some current is flowing, I ampere, in this coil. No rotation, etc. What I want to study, how to obtain, suppose it is carrying some current now, and this side will be cross, this side is dot, DC current. What will be the field pattern produced in the air gap of the machine? Because it is ultimately that B distribution must be known in order to calculate either voltage BLV or torque BIL, etc. So B distribution is important, and nature of B will essentially decide what will be the nature of the voltage induced. Sinusoidal or whatever way B changes, induced voltage will change. So often what is done to analyze this sort of rotating machine, people consider developed diagram. Developed diagram. What they simply do is this. You imagine this machine is cut here. And developed, made it linear like this, unfolded the machine. Then how it will look like? Machine will look like, stator will be like this, stator iron. I mean, straighten it. Cut it here, straighten it. And length of the machine will be perpendicular to the board. This is suppose stator. This is stator. And then comes your air gap. Air gap will look like this. And then the two slots somewhere, if you cut it here, suppose you have cut it there. So two slots will be like this, here one slot, and diametrically opposite another slot. And this is also iron. And there is a conductor here, there is a conductor here. This is carrying cross current, this is current, dot current. Conductor is perpendicular to the board. So developed diagrams are often referred to in order to calculate or analyze the machine, particularly B distribution, etc. Suppose it is a single turn coil like this, it is carrying some I current. I want to find out B in the air gap. So how do I calculate? I will first calculate H, then I will multiply it with mu. Now H calculation is very simple in this case. the lines of forces produced by this coil will be like this. Apply that right hand rule, cross lines of forces will be circling like this. Let us assume the permeability of iron is very large or very large compared to air. Therefore, whatever MMF will be produced, that will be consumed where? To overcome the reluctance of the air gap. Anyway, today I stop here and next class I will carry on.